Some films were harmed in the making of this podcast.
Hello and welcome to another episode of For Your Consideration,
the podcast featuring roundtable discussions reevaluating the cinematic canon of past masterpieces and modern classics. I'm Mike Josick.
And I'm Dustin Friesenan.
Thanks for joining us. So on this episode of the show, we're going to be talking about the 1996 British black comedy drama film, Trainspotting.
AKA that film where if you pay very close attention, you can spot a train.
So just before we get into the movie, I've got one below-the-line item that I wanted to cover. We recently launched a brand new microcast, which is a solo effort on the part of my esteemed co-host, Dustin Friesenhan, in which Dustin watches, perchance, some of the worst films in history.
And as opposed to the best worst film, these are films that I did not enjoy, which is a rarity for me.
And to be fair, when I say worst films, I guess these are transgressive films, exploitation films, dark horror.
Not necessarily all of them. It just seems to be that those are the ones that are popping to mind as I choose them right now. But they're movies that just manage to get everything wrong.
Okay, so in the course of the show, which is called In Case You're Considering, you will be covering movies other than just some of those gross, dingy, sloppy movies.
Yeah, okay. It's just that some of those gross, dingy, sloppy movies tend to not be good.
So what you're saying is that my whole marketing push in the beginning here has been a little off.
Yes, I am.
Fair enough. So yeah, if you haven't checked it out yet, they're very short episodes. When I say microcast, I mean they're like 10 minutes long. It's taking out the dog for a walk for a poop. It's running to the 7-Eleven. It's it's a quick listen. But they're entertaining. Dustin gives his particular viewpoint on them, which I have fun editing them. I'm sure you'll have fun listening to them.
If you say so.
The other thing that I wanted to point out is I've kind of decided that I want to get a little more into potentially interviewing people as well for the podcast. And I recently exhumed an old interview I did back in 98 with Edward Ross Flynn, who was the artist for Darren Aronofsky's Pie the Book of Ants. It's obviously an older interview, but Pie the Book of Ants was a comic book that Darren Aronofsky himself wrote. He wasn't sure if his film Pie was going to be able to find life as a movie about God and math and chaos, who was going to fund that. So he kind of did a two-pronged attack, figured he'd do either comic books, which was one of his loves, and film, which was another one of his loves. And the film actually did end up taking off, and only one issue of the comic ever actually made it to print. It was published by Dark Horse Comics and Artisan Entertainment. I remember at the time I almost got to talk to Darren Aronofsky about the comic book, but things just started ramping up around the film, and Ed couldn't get me into contact with him. He was busy. It's always been like just that one, two trains in the night kind of missed opportunity things. It's always...
Such is life.
It's been like, damn! So that's posted up on the blog, which you can find at fycshow.wordpress.com. And in case you're considering, first episode featuring the 1987 film Necromantic, Dustin's new microcast, spin-off from the FYC main show. Be sure to check that out as well. Those are two new things in the FYC canon for you to enjoy and experience.
But so, yeah. Yes, if you want some more of our unsolicited opinions on movies and film, anything related to, thereof, thereby, wherefore...
Maybe that should have been the name of the podcast, Unsolicited Opinions.
A.K.A. the Internet.
A.K.A. that podcast featuring roundtable discussions.
We will introduce ourselves as that one time.
All right, so rolling the credits on Trainspotting. The film was directed by Danny Boyle, produced by Andrew McDonald. Screenplay was by John Hodge, based on the novel Trainspotting by Irvine Welsh. It stars Ewan McGregor, Ewan Bremner, Johnny Lee Miller, Kevin McKidd, Robert Carlyle, and Kelly McDonald. Cinematography was by Brian Tufano, It was edited by Masahiro Hirakubo, and it was released on the 23rd of February 1996 in the UK. It is ranked 10th by the BFI in its list of top 100 British films of all time. And on the Sight and Sound Greatest Films of All Time list, it ranks 588th on the critics' poll and 546th on the director's poll. So, Dustin, what did you think of Trainspotting?
I haven't seen this movie for, once again, about 10 years. There's a lot of these movies where that seems to be the case, and I'm watching them again with hopefully more experienced eyes, more critical eyes. But this movie, I thought it did a lot of things very right that you see a lot of movies of its type do very wrong. A lot of movies that talk about sort of the dangers of drug use and all that, I feel that they can definitely get way more preachy than they should be. But one thing I love that this movie did right off the huff was he was talking about, nobody really talks about how awesome it feels. Take the best sex you've ever had in your life, the best orgasm, 1,000 times better, not even close. Obviously, there's a reason people keep going to drugs. One of the reasons why any sort of a drug program doesn't work, like DARE or scared straight things. If someone says you take a puff of marijuana and next thing you know, you're killing your family with an axe, a la fucking
Reefer Madness.
Reefer Madness, exactly. A la Reefer Madness. Somebody sees someone take a puff and there's no axe murders. They're like, oh, so I've been lied to. Well, isn't that just dandy? And so how do you trust opinions like that?
That was actually something that the screenwriter mentioned in an interview where somebody had criticized the film for glamorizing drug use. And he said, we had to show why people enjoy it. We had to show why these characters like doing this so much.
And how are you glamorizing something when they're living in complete squalor, talking about how they will do anything for their next hit? Like, I mean,
this is an economically depressed group of people living in economically depressed situations, and the heroin is one of their escape routes. Like, this isn't like a The Wolf of Wall Street.
One of the few times that people aren't living in these dingy little sort of rat holes, sleeping on these messy mattresses, are when the main character makes it out to London and he's got himself a little job. But they talk about all the good and the bad, and yeah, it's mostly bad. And even he's like, you know what, I have to get off this drug. And he does. But he also shows how easy it is to fall back into it. How it's usually your friends who you used to do it with, which are the thing that'll keep you from really staying clean. After like long periods of time, you sort of get dragged back in because of the people who you knew. No matter how good things might be going for a bit of time. Talks about the depression, how you try comparing everything to the highs you used to have. And you try to do different things to get out of it. I've seen people and known people who've gone through the overdoses, who've hated the drug life, but still keep going back to it.
I like little things like, you obviously have a biased narrator in Renton, but he talks about, they don't talk about the heroin addiction as a sickness, they talk about coming off heroin addiction as getting the sickness.
He's like, I could see the sickness, it's coming. It's in the mail.
And I think they did a really good job, like you said, of showing both the good and the bad. They do glamorize it. They talk about how it's better than the best orgasm you've ever had times 1,000. Like, honestly, like watching Fight Club. After watching Fight Club, I want to get in a fight. While watching this, kind of want to do heroin. But there's the obvious, there's both sides to it. And these are not great people. They're not living in a great situation.
He specifically says that he's a terrible person.
And, you know, the parents are played in a very kind of domineering, boring, dull sort of way. Like, they're made to look like just serious killjoys of everything fun and cool. But
at the same time, one of the killjoys that they had was a raving psychopath, which is another thing I liked. Not everyone who's sober is good in the movie either. It's not so black and white.
In the process of getting Renton clean, I was actually, it hit me pretty solidly that these people who are sort of portrayed as being totally uncool and, you know, disapproving of Renton, and they're probably just horribly glum British parents, they love their kid enough to actually go through this process and get him clean. And they didn't do it in like a, you know, tough as nails, Clockwork Orange kind of way. Like, there was genuine, we're going to get you through this. And I think that's one of the strengths of Danny Boyle's portrayal of this as well, is that you get a sense that there's tenderness and love there. It's not just, oh, our shitty kid, he's a drug addict and we need to get him clean because he's ruining our lives.
And I've seen both sides of that for sure. in the some of the people that I've known in the past. It feels very real as far as all of this is concerned. And that is one of the things that I find as a very good strength of this movie.
And they play up a lot of the humor of some of the ridiculous situations, like the best drunk stories that you hear from your friends where, you know, oh, I can't believe this person did that. You know, seeing Spud shit himself and the stuff fly all over the place.
Nothing ever goes good for Spud.
You know, like, there's a lot of really funny moments in this movie, and those moments are always sort of, there's a counterpoint, you know, like, there's a real darkness, there's a dark heart to this film, and I think that humor is what makes it so watchable. The humor and the style of direction and editing, like, the choices that they made took this very dark, unpleasant topic, and they made it palatable so that you could actually watch this highly non-narrative sort of story, and it gives you an idea of what it was like, or what it's like to be young, poor, and a heroin addict, both the highs and the lows, and it's a bit of a commentary on it, and like you said, even Renton admits, I'm not a good person.
He hopes to fix himself up, and every now and then he gets that goal in mind.
So there's a lot of things kind of going on, and it's never really pulling you in any one direction, or, I mean, it doesn't even necessarily preach that you shouldn't do heroin.
It's just telling you a story.
It's just telling you a story, and it's showing you these characters who, you know, Renton, obviously, once he's off, he decides he's going to stay off, whether that's for legal reasons or a personal choice, but then his friends just sort of insinuate themselves back into his life. And,
friggin' Bigsby.
Oh, Begbie, I know.
Begbie, sorry.
That actually, his performance, Robert Carlyle's performance of Begbie colored my view of Robert Carlyle for years. He was so shitty as a human being. I'm sure Robert Carlyle is a very pleasant person, but there were movies that I just kind of... I probably didn't watch Stargate Universe because Robert Carlyle was in it. And I just thought he was such a raving asshole. I think I was just trying to make a point that the movie is really well balanced, and it's very well put together to be entertaining.
And to still get across its message.
Without being preachy. Which I think is it's a delicate balance to maintain.
Very delicate balance. They even have the transcendent art scene of the dead baby in there, which you were saying is one of the reasons why a lot of people have a very hard time watching the movie, especially a second time. And that is something that is going to hit a lot of people very hard, but they do it as tastefully as is humanly possible.
And it's interesting, too, that they, like, that dead baby thing is so dark. Like, even watching it again just now, I mean, it hit me pretty hard. It's just such an unpleasant thing to sort of cope with on any level. But they just move past it because...
They get high, they forget about it. And it comes back again only once during his... when he comes down and all the shit that he's done hits him again, which is what I've heard from people coming down.
And Renton is your narrator, and as I said, he's a biased narrator. So Renton doesn't care. Renton, the only thing that Renton really cared about was that it kind of killed his buzz, and we found out it was Sick Boy's baby.
He didn't even care when he completely ruined Tommy's life by simply taking a video. He didn't fess up to it. He got Tommy into heroin himself, and then there's the AIDS, and you're just talking about toxoplasmosis in the back of his funeral. And then his buddies come up and make him feel a little bad about it by talking about this skag deal that they got going down. He's like, really? We just buried the guy and you're talking about this. Really? And it wasn't because he cared about Tommy. It's because, man, I got a decent thing going on here. Stop trying to get me involved in your illegal stuff. He didn't care about Tommy, even at that point.
And speaking of Tommy, just while we're on the topic of Tommy, holy crap, Kevin McKidd. I mean, this movie, I've known, you know, Johnny Lee Miller, Ewan Bremner, Robert Carlyle, Ewan McGregor, they're kind of legendary in these roles. But even watching it this time, I did not pick up that was Kevin McKidd until the credits played. I was like, holy crap. And I mean, Kevin McKidd's been in so many things after that. And he just looks and sounds different. Just surprised me.
They did a lot of scenes really well when it came to cuts and, well, especially when he was coming down, detoxing. And they have that scene where Begbie's in the other side of the bed, and then he spins around, but it looks like one shot, and now he's in a single bed instead of a double, with Begbie on the other side. There's a lot of really good camera work in here, and a lot of good small, minor special effects. that are beautiful. Even if you have some odd things like the carpet lining his sides during his overdose.
That looks so good.
So good, yet it looked so bad at the same time. When but he was down in the carpet himself.
There's that conceit that, like, you mentioned the baby on the roof being like the fakest looking baby, the baby on the ceiling. But he was going through withdrawal symptoms, so you can kind of play with that and make something not look as real as maybe a real baby on the ceiling. And honestly, a real baby on the ceiling probably would have been disturbing for the viewer as well, especially after having to see the dead baby earlier in the film.
And the baby's fake-looking face before it falls on him.
But I think you're allowed, you know, especially when they're high or when, you know, going through withdrawal, or there's a heightened reality or...
a dulled reality, but an altered reality nonetheless.
Exactly.
Though if there's one thing that they could have definitely played with a little bit, which they did not at all, hair growth. Everybody's hair was exactly the same the whole time. He was never not clean shaven, even coming down for however long in his room there. His hair was always a nice clean buzz cut. These guys kept their facial hair and hair immaculately trimmed the exact same time over these years that this movie took place in.
It's always something with you.
It's always something. I point it out now because in the film I noticed it. And there's some where I notice the change of time and people will change their hair within the film. And it's something I've started picking up on in movies. Just little subtle things to let you know that the passage of time is going on. And in this movie, I don't know the passage of time. They mention once it's been a year since he's talked to Tommy, or Spud obviously went to jail for 6 months and he was out later on, so okay, that obviously happened. But it couldn't have been too long because the high school girl he hooked up with was still in high school for the whole thing.
I think probably a year is maybe a good guesstimate for the span that the film takes place in.
But some things seem like it would take a lot longer, like how long Begbie's crashing at his place. Wouldn't it have been longer that he was hiding out for the armed robbery? I don't know. And they are not keen to tell me.
But I think Renton probably left for London well before Spud got out of jail.
Oh, yeah. So, he got the letter from his underage hookup, which I guess he was keeping in contact with. Because, once again, they didn't mention that so much. She blackmails him with, "You're keeping in contact with me, otherwise I'm telling the police," but then you hear from her like once more later on after he's come down.
But then again, if you're looking at it from the perspective of Renton being your biased narrator, you're seeing the story
through, that he wants to tell.
That he wants to tell through Renton's eyes. So if he's blurring timelines, if he chooses to see everybody, and I, you know, this could literally just be pulling perspective or meaning right out of my ass. But if this is how he perceives all of his friends, sort of this is the image of them, and you're not necessarily seeing the natural progression of time, you wouldn't see somebody, you know, getting scruffy, or just like you don't see bathrooms, you know, on the Death Star. Oh, sorry, refreshers.
And see, that I would agree is kind of pulling it a little bit out of your arse there.
I try.
Tommy, on the other hand, you do see a bit of a progression with him as he develops HIV and has the sores and whatnot on his face. And certainly his room looks a heck of a lot different.
Sorry, there's just so many scenes in that movie that are like dark as fuck. Like that kitten and the slow pullback of the camera while they're talking about him getting toxoplasmosis.
Toxoplasmosis.
Toxoplasmosis. And it stops to reveal like his feet. As they say, he died face down in his own vomit, and the neighbors, you know, complained about the smell, and that's how he got found. And the little kittens, they're going, meow. And then they go, the kitten's okay, though. So even at, like, this really dark moment, there's that line with this casual disregard for the human life, and it's very, very black comedy. Very British comedy.
And I can definitely tell that I'm becoming very desensitized to movies, because none of it fazed me whatsoever. I'm so good at making that distinction between film and reality. If I see something small and not too bad happening to someone in real life, I'm upset. I see the most horrible thing happen in a movie. Eh. I don't know what that says about me, though. Other than, hopefully, just a very good distinction between reality and fiction.
It's very possible. A little bit ago, you mentioned something about the cutting of the film. And I think that's probably one of the greatest strengths of this movie, especially since, like I had mentioned earlier in the conversation, the movie is, it's almost entirely devoid of narrative. There isn't really like a lot of story until you get to the heist, which is like 2/3 of the way through the movie. And otherwise, it's just a bunch of kind of vignettes and just introducing you to the lives of these characters. But the editing of it, the pacing of the film, the performances, like the strength of those characters, it's also the writing and the music. The soundtrack for this film is, it's appropriately a loved soundtrack. Like, there's some great punk and pop stuff on this movie.
I love that techno beat at the club when Begbie doesn't know what a man looks like in a dress.
And also, like, the music was used to show differences in... Diane says to Renton, you know, music's changing, drugs are changing. And they use, in that scene, the music to sort of indicate, you know, you're going from, like, Iggy Pop to, like, this high techno stuff. And Renton's going, she's right. Like, music's changing. The scene is changing. Things are changing.
I should grow up a little.
And I think the music is just used to such great effect. And it's such great music. And honestly, I don't know... I don't think Danny Boyle has really... trying to think of something in the last few years that he's done that's had this kind of vitality and energy to it. I can't really think of anything since 28 Days Later. You know, as much as I love Sunshine, and I love Sunshine.
That one did have an awesome track.
It's such a differently paced movie, though. Like, this one has what Darren Aronofsky once referred to as kind of hip-hop editing. Like, it's a lot of quick cuts and jumpy, and but not losing you, like catching you in a rhythm. I do think it's interesting also that this movie, it shares a lot of similarities to Shallow Grave, which is one of my favorite Danny Boyle and Ewan McGregor movies. Their first collaboration.
That was a good movie.
It was a great movie. But there again, you have friends. You have friends who are willing to betray each other over money. None of them are good people.
Trainspotting Zero. The prequel.
Kind of. And I mean... very, very different characters in Christopher Eccleston and Carrie Fox, but still very thematically, I think, tied to Trainspotting. It didn't seem like too big of a jump. And as I was watching the movie, because again, like you, it's probably been a good 10, 15 years since I've seen the movie. I just couldn't help but see the references. I was like, that's something I'm going to point out on the podcast.
And here we are in the future. In the year 2000.
You do that like every 3 or 4 episodes.
Now who's exaggerating?
I'm going to start making that our new theme song.
We're going to have to make a tally.
All right, so we've talked about acting, directing, music, editing.
Nitpicking.
There was some nitpicking.
There's always nits to be found.
Is there anything you need to add before we move on to the next segment?
Not that I can think of.
All right. So we'll move on into the...
Wait, it's a stupid little thing that I enjoy seeing in movies... regardless of whether or not I actually enjoy seeing it, it's not just female full frontal. I, for whatever reason, I enjoy actually just seeing a dong in there, as dumb as it sounds.
Oh, just on the principle.
Oh, entirely on the principle. Yeah. Instead of having one gender covered up completely and the other one not, I like that kind of equality. And it's something that's finally coming to North America a bit, is it? I don't know.
Eh.
I haven't seen many movies lately that have had much nudity. Not slasher films, for sure. They still don't show junk.
Ewan Bremner and the two Ewans both showed their junk. Ewan McGregor's never been shy about showing his junk, though. There's a few movies. But it is. It's a real problem. You know, it's just as bad to be glorifying the female nudity and shaming the male nudity. Like, just be cool with the nudity. And on the flip side, you know, you're fine with exploding heads and, you know, hammering.
You have exploding heads, you have death, you have gore, you have violence. It's PG, PG-13. The second there's a penis in there, according to some of the rules that I've read online, it might have changed recently, but that used to be an automatic NC-17, which is insane. And you can see it in some movies where you're like, wow, there's a lot of violence in here. PG, are you kidding me? And then you have any sort of sexual anything, and it's immediately an R. And that's starting to shift very slightly, but if you watch, like, this film has not yet been rated, you'll see some of the insane issues that plague that.
That's a great movie. And so informative for how any of this shit gets through.
Absolutely.
But that's a discussion for another time. All right, so moving on to the judgment phase. Dustin, is Trainspotting a museum piece or a masterpiece?
I'd actually put it as a masterpiece pretty easily. It covers everything subtly that it needs to cover subtly. It shows what it needs to show. I could nitpick a couple small things, but those definitely aren't big enough to cause any sort of issue. Certainly you defended them in the "it's a good movie, so I'm going to find a reason to defend it" manner.
I retconned the fuck out of that.
Oh yeah, retconning, that's almost a proof sometimes of whether or not a movie is good or not, when people retcon any bad thing to be suddenly, "that was intentional, that was good for this reason." Whereas if you see it in another movie, "that was garbage because of this reason. Had this famous director done it, I would have believed it was intentional." But yes, I'd say it is a masterpiece, one that shows drugs in an honest light and addiction and the damage that it can do, without glamorization, without condemnation, without all the things that I see far too often that don't work. And it definitely is worth the acclaim that it got, the accolades.
And I would agree with you that I will also classify Trainspotting as a masterpiece. I was actually, as I often am, a little bit torn, but upon reflection, I think this movie does such a good job of what you said, being honest about drug use and drug users. And when I say honest, I'm thinking of showing what's potentially awesome about drugs, like we discussed before, and also like honest consequences of using drugs and abuse. And there's so much more going on here than just the drugs. Like the heroin is just part of the story and part of what brings these characters together. And just everything we discussed earlier about, you know, what a great balancing act everybody involved did, and the great performances. And I think it's...
And once again, the morality not being black and white, which is such a huge thing for me.
And to be as entertaining as it is and as dark as it is, and, you know, carry a message and be thought-provoking, and yeah, I feel comfortable backing the masterpiece on this one.
Well, there you have it. 2 votes for yay from your favorite For Your Consideration podcast.
And now that we've both voted it a masterpiece, I think I'm going to go and watch Trainspotting 2. I'm actually really interested to see how these characters have developed and what happens when Renton returns. Perhaps, you know what? That's either going to be an afterthoughts on the website, or that might get brought up in an All Things Considered episode. That's a promise.
It's maybe going to happen. That's a promise. It's like being a weatherman. Doesn't matter if you're right or wrong. You're telling the truth.
The only job where you can be wrong 90% of the time and not get fired.
No. Sports announcers. Come on now.
So if you have any thoughts on Trainspotting or on our discussion and opinions on it, unsolicited opinions. Actually, no, if you've clicked on the episode, you've solicited our opinions.
You knew what you were doing.
I think that's fair to say.
You had this coming. This is your fault, really, if you think about it.
As usual, you can find us on Facebook. We're on Twitter at FYC Show. Follow, share, subscribe, all the things. We're on Instagram. You can also find the show on iHeartRadio and Stitcher if you have any friends that you know that use those providers. And if you use iTunes to download and listen to the show, we would love it if you took the time. It doesn't take long. Rate the show, write a review, let us know what you think, and any comments, good or bad, we will read on the show in a future episode. That also is a promise. So thanks again for joining us. We appreciate your support and listening to the show. Until next time, I'm Mike Joseph.
And I'm Dustin Friesenan.
Take care.
Ta-ta.
I'm trying to remember what Danny Boyle's last movie was. And I'm going to go to the internet, and maybe Dustin will talk while I do it.
Or maybe he'll leave us in awkward silence.
Which you can totally do, because editing, bitches. Danny Boyle. Oh, Danny Boyle.